So last time we talked about making lesson plans and preparing for teaching math concepts, in particular algebra. Today we are going to cover science. Many times math and science go together, and your major will be math and science. So I want to talk first of all about approaching the science classroom. How do you approach your science classroom? What are you trying to do? What are you trying to teach? So approaching the science classroom, first thing I want you to understand is that science class needs to be closer to math class. It should be more like a math class, less and less like a history class. In history class, you are lecturing, you are giving out information, you are talking about events that occurred in the past, you're learning dates, you're learning places, you're learning important people. Science does involve learning facts, does involve learning structures and learning different types of animals or types of organs or different things. And of course, when we're dealing with science, in particular, I want to talk about the life sciences, the biological sciences. And yes, you do have to learn a lot of information, but that is not the approach that you should be taking. So as you approach your science class, it should not be what I'm going to say lecture-based. And by that, I mean, that's not all you're doing. You're not just lecturing. It's not a history type class. It needs to be more than a lecture. Will you lecture in your science class? Yes, and you will lecture a lot, but that is not the overall approach. So the overall approach then needs to be the idea of instilling science skills. What are science skills? If I were to ask you, what are some math skills? You would say, oh, basic computation, like addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division. We want our students to graduate from high school with math skills. We want our students to graduate from high school with good reading skills, reading comprehension. We want our students to be able to write. What about math? We know about math skills. What about science skills? What are science skills? In the overall grand scheme of life, does it really matter if you know the parts of a flower? No, it doesn't. So we want to learn how to do science. All right, so that's what I mean as approach. I think you need a different approach to your science class. Science class is not just lecture based. Science class should not just be giving out information. We need to approach our science class from the standpoint of instilling science skills. In my teaching science class, I will ask the students to name a science skill, and everybody doesn't know what to say. Okay, that's because maybe their science class was a little too much like their history class, giving out information, learning the names of the systems of the body, learning the parts of a flower, learning the different groups of animals. Well, that's not all there is to the life sciences. And the life sciences are especially useful in learning science skills. The life sciences aren't as mathematically based as your physical sciences, like chemistry and physics. Those classes lend themselves to solving problems and actually doing science. Sometimes when our biological sciences and we're just studying living things, we don't have the problems to solve like we do in physics. We don't have the equations to balance like we do in chemistry. So we tend to just approach biology classes learning information. And it shouldn't be just learning information. It should be instilling science skills. So the first thing that you should do when you're going to teach a life science class, or any science class for that matter, is change your approach. You should approach your science class more as a practical time to learn science skills, not just giving out all this science information, not just providing students with facts that they have to learn for a quiz and for the test. Change your approach to your science class. Because as I said a minute ago, of all the sciences, the life sciences tend to be a little bit too much just learning names of parts, just learning types of animals, just learning the 11 systems of the body, instead of learning how to do science. So, in order to do this, first of all, we have to know what science is. What is science? If we're going to approach our science class from a different perspective, from learning how to do science instead of just learning science fact, we have to know what is science. Well, the root word, of course, means to know. But in common usage, the word science is much more closely aligned with the word investigate. Not learn facts, but science should be investigation. So if we're going to change the approach to our science class and we're going to try to get further and further away from just giving out science information, just taking tests and quizzes, and we learn to actually do science. So the first step to actually doing science is to know what science is. Okay, science is investigation. The whole essence of science can be summarized in two words: inquiry and discovery. And how do we do science? How do we investigate? Well, we ask a pertinent question. We pose a question or present a problem. That's the inquiry part. And then we have to discover the answer. Well, how do we do that? We investigate. We experiment. All right, so what is science? Science isn't a collection of facts for me to learn. Science isn't a list of definitions for me to write out for my quiz. Science should be investigation. So I want to approach it that way as the teacher. So my first question is, what is science? Science is investigation. Science should be inquiry and discovery. Inquiry, that means we're going to ask a question, pose a problem, and then we are going to find the answer. Discovery, finding the answer through experimentation, through observation. All those things that I just started listing brings us to the next thing. What are science skills? What are science skills? If our goal of our class is to do science, not just learn science facts, and our goal then is to teach students some science skills so that our students leave high school with reading skills, writing skills, math skills, but how about a little bit of science skills? Something that they can actually use and do for problem solving. So science skills. Let me give you some science skills. Can anybody name one? I just said a few.
Observation.
That's number two. Let's start with the beginning. The first science skill is question. Now, question can also be a verb. It's not just a noun. Question. Question means to form precise and pertinent questions. A big part of science is learning what questions to ask, how to frame those questions, how to narrow the question down. That's one of the hardest things about a research paper, is the topic, narrowing the topic down. Because you should, of course, with a research paper, you should have a thesis statement that you are going to explain and support in your research paper. And so it's very similar to science. Okay, science is research. And the research, good science, begins with a precise and a pertinent question. So the first science skill is the ability to form those questions. Question means to form precise and pertinent questions. A second science skill is observe. Okay, so we're going to use these as verbs, something that we should be doing. If we're practicing science, we should be questioning. We should be observing. So observe. What does it mean to observe? Many times we get stuck on just the eye senses, visual sense, but it's more than that. Observe means to watch attentively. You're watching attentively. You're looking closely at. You're looking closely in a systematic way to gather information. So observation is gathering information. Yes, many times it is visual. Watching attentively. Looking closely in a systematic way. But the key is to gather information. It's not limited to sight. It can include any of your five senses, not just sight. And so we have to practice observation skills. Okay, that's a skill, being able to observe, whether it's visually or any of the other four senses, to gather information. Observation involves gathering information with one of your five senses. Another skill is classify. These are things that we do. So I want you to change your approach to your science class as doing science, not learning science facts. So we learn to question. We learn to observe. We learn to classify. Classify is when you arrange or organize data according to established standard categories. Classify. So that's something we can teach even elementary students to do, to classify. This is a science skill. Another science skill, hypothesize. Well, we're going to begin by forming a question. Then we're going to gather information by observation. We'll be observing. We will need to organize and classify our information. Then we can hypothesize. Hypothesize means to form an explanation to account for a set of facts that can be tested by further investigation. So science isn't learning facts. Science shouldn't be Trivial Pursuit, where you can give information out, like that board game, should it? Science is investigation. So we're going to question, we can observe, we can classify, we can hypothesize. Hypothesize means to formulate an explanation that accounts for a set of facts that can be further tested by investigation. So, question. We need to form precise and pertinent questions. Observe. We need to gather information using one of our five senses. Classify is how we organize and arrange data into specific categories that are standardized. Hypothesize. Formulate an explanation. These are skills that should be developed in students. It's part of getting an education. So when we approach our science class, we need to approach it differently. Another skill is to sequence. Sequence is to arrange in order of occurrence or importance. That's something else that we can teach students to do. That's one way that we can do science. Not just learn facts. We want to do science. Experiment. Of course, that one is where we test the validity of our hypothesis. That's something that we do in science class. So it's something that has to be taught. Just like you have to teach students how to add, subtract, multiply, and divide. You also have to teach students how to experiment, teach students how to observe, teach students how to classify. Another science skill is measuring. That's a skill that we can instill in both math and science class. To measure means to make a comparison between an object and a standardized unit. Okay, if I'm going to measure the width of the podium, I'm going to compare it to a standardized unit, probably the inch. Okay, that's measure, to make a comparison between an object and a standardized unit. Another math skill is describe. Many students cannot describe something. Describe means to provide a detailed explanation of a subject's or object's characteristics. Detailed explanation of an object or a subject's characteristics. Another thing we can do in science class, all of these are verbs: question, classify, observe, experiment, measure. Another thing we can do is analyze. This is to examine data methodically and separate it into parts or basic principles. Analyze. Examine data methodically and separate it into parts or basic principles. Another thing we can do, this is also in math class, graph. Graph is how you display your data in some type of visual format. Graph is to display data in some type of visual format, something that's what we also do in math class. So let's, as we are approaching our science class, it's not just giving out information. It's not just learning facts. It's doing science. It's practicing science skills. Closer in format and closer in goal to a math class, not a history class. So we're going to graph, which is means to display data in some type of visual format. Another skill is estimation. We need to teach students how to estimate. Estimation is when you make an approximate calculation. It's an approximate calculation. This is important when you're making sense of data. Does that data even make sense? Or is the number too large or too small? Estimation. Predict. Another verb. We want to teach our students to predict. To predict means to make known in advance. To make known in advance the outcome. That's another science skill. Predict. Another science skill is to record. And this is to put data into writing. So we want to change the approach to our science class. Science class should not just be giving out information. Sometimes I'll use the word spew. As a teacher, I should not just be up there spewing out all these facts. That can be very useless. So what I want to do when I approach my science class is I want to approach it as instilling science skills, teaching my students to be problem solvers, teaching my students to be able to do some of those science skills that we just described. Because not all of them are just for science class only. Being able to observe, being able to question, being able to hypothesize, find an explanation. All of those are things that we can do and teach our students how to do using especially our biological sciences. All right, so that's the first point, approaching your science lesson. Next, preparing lecture notes. I just said that it's not just lecture, but that we still have to give out information. We still have to learn the name of the structures that we're studying. We still have to learn science vocabulary. We do still do a lot of lecturing in science class, but it shouldn't be an end in itself. It's just a means to the end of being able to understand and do science. So you will need to prepare lecture notes in science class. So in preparing lecture notes, first of all, plan ahead. When we did the last lecture on preparing to teach, a part of preparing to teach a math lesson is planning. Also, a big part of planning or doing a science lesson and covering certain science topics begins with planning. So we're going to plan by making up a course outline. You will have to decide which chapters in your textbook to cover, which topics to cover. It's not possible for you to teach everything that you want them to know about the life sciences in one class. Okay, freshman biology. You can't cover everything about biology in 1 year. So you will have to decide which topics, which chapters to cover. And the second thing you decide is how much time in each chapter. You have to make a tentative overall plan. Many times this will be referred to as a course outline. You can't just start at the beginning of your textbook and start plowing through. You won't get very far. So you'll need to decide which topics or chapters to cover and how much time to spend in each chapter, each topic. What are you going to skip? How much time are you going to spend there? So the first thing in preparing your lecture notes is you need to have a plan of how much you're going to cover that year, how much time you're going to spend. Then the second step of your lecture, preparing a lecture, is to research. Science will involve extra research. First of all, it's not limited to the textbook. You need to go beyond the textbook. If you're going to teach science, you need to be there to teach and to instill science skills. Not just monitor them as they're reading the textbook. That's not teaching. Okay, if you're going to teach, you're going to research beyond the textbook. Your lecture should not just be an outline of the chapter. It shouldn't be. You might start with that, especially as a new teacher, but your lecture notes should not just be an outline of the chapter. If you're just going to do that, you might as well just hand them the textbook and say, read chapter one. So it should not be limited to the textbook. Don't just outline the textbook. Your textbook should just be one of many sources. This is true in history class. Don't just outline the chapter. You should give them more than the textbook. And you're going to have differences of opinion between what you should cover in which chapter and what you shouldn't. So you want the lecture to come from you, not just the textbook. So not limited to your textbook. Don't outline the chapter. Use your own organization. Have your own thoughts of what you think is important. And this will only come if you do your own research. So it's not limited to the textbook. A second idea is use other publishers' textbooks. Use other level textbooks, and of course, if you're going to use the internet, you're going to want to do that carefully. Use credible sources, especially in today's day and age with the internet. There's all kinds of research that you can do relatively quickly from the internet. However, credible sources. Wikipedia doesn't count. You want to use sources that are peer-reviewed. So what you want to do, as far as the internet is concerned, is you want to start from reputable sources. Universities have websites. Science foundations have websites. don't just use whatever you find out there. But there's really no excuse for you not to be able to build your own knowledge and draw from other sources before you start your lecture. So the first thing you do is plan. You want to plan out your year as much as you can. The second thing you do is research. Then the next thing you do is organize. Plan, research, organize. There's going to be a wealth of information out there, and sometimes the more research you do, the more information you have, the more you have to be careful and choose, careful what you choose to actually present. You'll have to decide more. Sometimes I end up doing too much research and I have too much information, then I have to cut it back. So the next thing you do is organize. First of all, you will have to prioritize by what's important. Especially in the biological sciences, there's so much information, there's so many different things you can learn, especially if you're doing human anatomy and physiology, there's so many interesting things about the human body that you'll have to be selective. So as you're organizing, you will have to prioritize by importance. You will have to be selective in what you are going to teach. You're going to be very much restrained by time. So you have to prioritize by importance. You'll have to be selective on what you teach, how much detail you give out, and how much time you're going to spend on it. So organization, prioritize. Okay, then the outline itself, making up an outline itself. Now, you don't have to teach by outline. In fact, we're going to talk about, as you give the lecture, do's and don'ts. And one of my lecture don'ts is don't dictate your outline. Okay, but many times you will organize using an outline. So we're going to plan, we're going to research, then we're going to organize. We have to prioritize our information according to importance, and we're going to be very selective on how much detail we're going to pick and choose. There's just too much information. Then writing the outline itself. First of all, the actual organization of the outline itself, strive to make parallel points. You want your outline to be parallel. And then the second idea is you want your outline to be consistent. And thirdly, you want your outline to be logical. That means it's going to follow a reasonable progression. It's logical. It follows a reasonable progression. Okay, so it's parallel, it's consistent, and it's logical. Now let me show you what I mean by this. And this is especially important at your lower levels. You want your students to be able to follow you through your outline quickly. You want it to make sense to them so that we can learn the information, get the information out there, learn the information, and then we can start doing some science. I don't want to have to spend my whole time teaching names and teaching structures and so forth. So the organization of the outline is very important. You want to get a wealth of information out there quickly. And then my number four is accurate. That kind of goes without saying, but we'll put it down. So the actual outline itself needs to be parallel, it needs to be consistent, it needs to be logical, and it must be accurate. Sometimes when we're paring our information down to size or trying to lower the level, we lose some of our accuracy. And then we propagate misconceptions because we've oversimplified. So you have to be careful with that. So here's what I mean by those points in the outline. if I was giving an outline on human anatomy and physiology, and I want to quickly go through and teach the systems of the body, I can do it much faster if my outline is parallel and, of course, logical and consistent. So if I'm going to quickly give an overview of the 11 body systems, I'm going to use Roman numerals for each system, right? And then I'm going to have the same points for every A, every B. So when we are doing the systems, let's say I want to start with the skeletal system. And then my Roman numeral number 2, I'm going to logically progress. A lot of times some books will start with the integumentary system, starting at the skin, the very outside of the body, then the muscles, then the bones. I like to start with the skeletal system. I really don't know why, but anyways, muscular system. So all of my Roman numerals are at the same level. They're all systems. That's parallelism. Then my capital letter A is going to be major organs. I want it to stay parallel, and I want it to be consistent. So what's capital letter A over here? Major organs. Okay. What are the organs of the muscular system? The skeletal muscles that are attached to your bones. What are the organs of the skeletal system are your bones. You have 206 bones and a whole lot more muscles. Okay? You see the parallelism? All the Roman numerals are at the same level. All the capital letter A's are the organs. Okay? Then, and then maybe in the skeletal system, I'll divide it into the appendicular skeleton and the axial skeleton. In the muscles, then, I'll divide them into the superficial muscles and the deep muscles. Okay, so I have it organized and I keep it parallel. Everything in capital letter A is all about the bones and the muscles. All right, then when I get to capital letter B, I'm going to do functions. So what's capital letter B with the muscular system? Functions. And then capital letter C, I'm going to do relationships to other systems. So capital letter C over here is going to be relationships. It's parallel. It's consistent. It's logical. Okay. And hopefully it's accurate. Okay. Don't give out inaccurate information. So anytime you're doing an outline, try to keep all the Roman numerals the same level or the same thing. These are all systems of the body. Capital letter A, it's all the major organs. And so that the outline is the same. If I'm going to go through the 11 systems, I want to go through them the same way. Okay? And then I don't have to dictate my outline because it's obvious. My organization should be obvious. So when you are writing an actual outline, look for parallelism. Be consistent. Follow a logical progression. And then always, always, always be accurate. With the biological sciences, there's really no chronology. Maybe if you're making up history notes, you're going to proceed in time order of time. But with biology, we don't have time order. We are not evolutionists. Okay? So when you're preparing your lecture notes, you've got to stick to your plan. You've got to plan out what you're going to do. Otherwise, you're going to get stuck in the middle of the textbook and you're not going to cover all the information that needs to be covered. Then you do need to do research, your own research, okay? I said not to outline the chapters. That's because it's much better for you to summarize and organize the information yourself. Okay? It'll be more meaningful to you, and it will be more pertinent to what you want to teach. All right, then organization. And then the writing the outline itself. So, I want you to approach your science class as teaching students how to do science, not just learning science facts. Okay, then when you prepare your lecture notes, because you want to efficiently get out the information, you don't want to spend all your class time lecturing, because we want to be able to do science. Then giving the lecture. The first thing I want to talk about with respect to giving the lecture is presentation do's and don'ts. Presentation do's and don'ts. All right, for our presentation do's and don'ts, let's start with do's. We'll be positive. We'll start with do's. And remember, what is science? Science is inquiry and discovery. We can't learn if we're not starting with a question. So you'll notice a lot of what I'm going to say in this lecture will be, I'm going to be asking you all kinds of questions, putting out all kinds of questions that we're going to be striving to answer in our science class. All right, presentation do's. First of all, do put the lesson in context. Put the lesson in context in two ways. Right, you're going to be going in there every day teaching. And as you are giving a lecture, you need to put that lecture in context. The first thing it needs to be in context with is, it's got to be in context with the previous lesson. All right, if I'm teaching human anatomy and physiology, I need to put it in context of the previous lesson. How do I do that? I review the concepts of the previous lesson very briefly, and then I ask questions. I get student feedback on the previous lesson. So I'm putting the lesson in context, first of all, where it fits in the overall scheme of the class. I have to put it in context with what we just lectured on yesterday or last week. Put it in context with the previous lesson. Review the content quickly, and then get student feedback. Ask questions. The second thing, you're going to put it in context with its own importance. Why are we learning this? And the reason is not so I can get an A in biology class. Okay, why am I learning this? How does it apply to me? Why is it important? All right, so the first thing is the first presentation do is put the lesson in context. Don't just jump in out of the blue starting on something. Next, do really teach. Really teach. So what is teaching? If I'm telling you, you need to teach the lesson, not read the textbook. You need to teach a lesson, not dictate an outline, not just give out random information. Try to do your best to really teach. So do put the lesson in context and do teach. What is teaching? If you look up teaching in the dictionary, there's all kinds of synonyms it's going to give you. Instructing, right? Telling, a big synonym is instruction. I have a better word. that I think we should make a synonym for teaching, and that is the word communicate. Teaching should be more communicating, not just instruction, not just giving it out. Okay, I keep moving my arms this way because this is all one way. I'm giving out information, aren't I? I'm instructing you. I'm telling you. Look, teaching needs to be more than that. Let's replace the word instruction, though that is part of it. Let's replace it with the word communicating. Teaching should be communicating. Communicating means, one of the definitions that I've seen for it is this, confirming for joint possession. I like that definition. So I might even want to define teaching that way. Teaching is confirming for joint possession. I have math skills. Right, I'm the math teacher, I have math skills, and one of my goals as the math teacher is to give you math skills. You need to possess math skills. What about science? I have science skills, I know science information, I have science knowledge, I want to give it to you. So teaching needs to be confirming for joint possession. I have my math skills, I have my science skills, I have knowledge of science, and I want to give it to you. How do I do it? Well, if you were robots, I could, you know, unscrew your head and pour it in. But it doesn't work that way. So communication, it has to be two-way. It has to be give and give back. Give and give back. But it has to even be more than that. Another way I've heard teaching described as painting a picture in the minds of your students. And to me, that kind of gives an idea of not only are you going to give it back to me, you're going to process it yourself. And you're going to be able to explain it in a different way. You're a different person. So it's not just I give you the definition, you quote it back to me. Is that confirming for joint possession? No, it's very temporary. It's very superficial. So confirming for joint possession means I'm giving it to you, and then you're taking it and you're making it your own. The word possession, you're not just borrowing it from me. You're taking it and you're making it your own. So that means you're going to change it. You're going to express it differently. You're going to explain it differently. Then it becomes yours. So teaching needs to have a goal of joint possession. Joint possession of knowledge and joint possession of skills. Okay, so when you're giving the lecture, you don't want to just give out information. You're not just giving out information. You are communicating information. You are confirming for joint possession. And we'll see this a little bit more when I talk about the don'ts, okay? So do put the lesson in context. Do really teach. What is teaching? Yes, teaching is instruction. Yes, teaching is giving out information. Yes, teaching involves lecturing, but that's not the goal. That's not the overall gist. I want you to think of teaching as communicating, as confirming for joint possession, as painting a picture in the minds of your students. That doesn't sound like just lecturing to me. Okay, so how do you teach? What is a teaching progression? What do I mean really teach? What do I mean communicate? I think teaching involves a couple of different things. I think teaching involves at least four verbs. Review, and the order can be whatever. The order would change. Review, repeat, lead, and lecture. Not just lecture. It involves reviewing. It involves repeating, restating, putting it a different way, leading and lecturing. Of course, we all know what review is. Review is I am putting things into context. I'm showing how it relates. I'm relating it to prior material. I'm reviewing. I'm reminding. All those have the idea of review. Repeat. And of course, this is supposed to be communication. So do I do all the reviewing? Do I do all the repeating? No. Repeat. A lot of teaching is repeating. When you actually repeat, you're reminding the students of what you just said. You're putting things in context. You're showing what things are important. Okay? So repeating. Leading. What do I mean by leading? Leading is where you try to get the students to express the information before you give it to them. A lot of times this involves asking what are called leading questions. What do you think about this? Or I'm teaching on the skeletal system. Have the students come up with the functions themselves. Of course, you're going to guide them in it. Don't you just list the functions for them? We don't want to just list the functions for them. How about getting them to engage their brain and having them think about what the functions of the skeletal system have to be? That's leading them, getting them to come up with the information on their own. And then lecture, yes, you will need to give out information. You will have to give them definitions. You will have to teach them the names of the structures. That's part of it. But it shouldn't be the only thing that you're doing. So review, repeat, lead, and lecture. You want to have a goal to really teach. So what do you want to do for your dues? You want to, yes, put the lecture in context. Do put the lesson in context. Number two, do teach. Number three, do use the blackboard. You want the students' eyes to help their mind see what you're saying, quite literally, but also understanding. A lot of understanding is going to involve them visualizing things. Many, if not most people, are visual learners, and they tend to forget and not even really understand things that they only hear. So do use the blackboard. Why? First of all, students need to see what you're saying. In biology, you're giving them all kinds of new names. And some of the names are difficult to spell. They've not heard those words before. They're unfamiliar. They need to literally see what you are saying. And keep in mind that the second reason is the eye is one of the main gates to the understanding. They are seeing what you're saying. And then also, it'll help keep students' attention. They're hearing it and they're seeing it. And then hopefully they're writing it. So we're engaging more of them if we use the blackboard. So students need to see what you're saying. The eye is the gate to their understanding. It'll help you keep their attention. And it also helps students keep up with your lecture. If you're introducing new words and names in the biological sciences, it's difficult to spell them and you can't keep up because you don't know what to write and where to put it and things like that. So you want to help your students by using the blackboard. So use the blackboard. Why? Students need to see what you're saying. How or what? First of all, what? Before I get to how. Why? Now, what should you write on the blackboard? First of all, always write unfamiliar words. Okay. If I'm teaching the skeletal system and I'm telling them that the upper arm bone is called the humerus, okay, they need to know how to spell humerus. It is not the same as humerus. Or we're learning more of the bones, and we're going to learn the clavicle, and we're going to learn the cranium. They're very unfamiliar that you need to write them. Also, it's very helpful to write lists on the board. If you want your students to learn three functions of the skeletal system, for example, if they see the list of the three functions together, it'll help them, just help them to associate them together in their mind. Visual learners. Charts. You can draw charts, and I a lot of times I'll call them a flow chart. Draw. Okay, this happens, then this happens. Especially if you're teaching in biology, you're teaching a function. A lot of things will happen sequentially. So you put the sequence up on the board. The first thing that happens is this, and then it splits into two parts here. So it flow charts, and then relationships. If you want to teach a relationship, you need to write them side by side on the board. Use the blackboard. Use the blackboard for unfamiliar words, especially since they will not know how to spell them. Okay? Use the blackboard to show lists to get students to associate things together. Use charts to illustrate what you're trying to explain, and you can use it to show relationships. How? You might want to practice your blackboard penmanship. New teachers are going to tend to write different sizes. Mine's not too bad, okay? But you need to practice your penmanship or use manuscript if you don't write well in cursive. And you're gonna tend to change, you're gonna have inconsistent sizes. Start big, get smaller, big, small, and you're gonna go uphill or downhill. It takes practice to not go uphill and downhill. Another thing you can do is write things ahead of time. So that you don't have to waste time trying to get something up on the board. So, use the blackboard. So you want to, yes, put the student in context, the lesson in context. Do it. Do teach. Number three, do use the blackboard. Number four, do illustrate as many points as possible. Illustrate what you're talking about. What does it mean to illustrate? It means to show them something. Show them by example, or show them with a picture or a diagram. So illustrate as many points as possible. You can illustrate orally by telling them a story or relating an event that illustrates what you're talking about. You can illustrate your points orally by telling a story or by giving an example or showing a parallel. And then you can illustrate visually. Even if you don't have a fancy visual aid prepared, you still need to show them visually. Use the textbook's diagrams. Use the curriculum's visual aids. Maybe they have overheads. Maybe they have PowerPoints. Use other books, pictures out of other books. Use the computer. So you want to illustrate your points, as many of them and as often as possible, orally and visually. So do put the lesson in context, do really teach, do use the blackboard, do illustrate every point. And then the last one here is do repeat. The other science class that I teach, called Teaching Science, or teaching elementary science, teaching intermediate science, we do a lot of demonstrations in class. Okay, because remember, science is not just lecture, it's doing. And these are things that I have to, when I'm grading them, giving them a grade on their presentation, on their demonstration, I'm constantly telling them to do these things. And one thing that I am telling them to do all the time is repeat. If you're teaching, can you say something one time? All right. Maybe I repeat too much, but I don't think so. I've been repeating my points as I go to help you keep up with me and to remind you of what I've been saying. So do repeat. In my notes here, I have written down this little Latin phrase, ad nauseum. What does that mean? It means the point of being sick of it. Repeat, repeat, repeat. So as I'm up there doing my science demonstration, I am constantly repeating my terminology, or I'm repeating the three things I want them to remember. Repeat, 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 repeat. Repetition is an important teaching technique that needs to be done by the teacher. Repeat. Rephrase. Repeat it again. There shouldn't be any downtime or dead time in the class. So if I am doing a science demonstration, I need to be talking the whole time. Maybe I'm doing some type of chemistry demonstration and I'm having to mix things together. So I just stand there and mix quietly? No, I'm repeating myself. I'm emphasizing important points. I'm repeating what I just said. I may be explaining it in a different way. So you want to repeat, and then you want to rephrase, and then repeat again. Don't allow any downtime or silence. Fill that time with repetition. The first type is repetition done by the teacher. The second type, require repetition by the students. You're going to repeat yourself ad nauseum. You keep repeating, repeating, repeating. But then you are going to require repetition by the students. Have the students describe what you just described to them. Try to get them to do it in their own words. But at least get them to repeat what you said. Hopefully you try to get them to process it. You want to engage their mind. Try to get them to explain it again. Describe what you just described. Ask the students to describe what you just described. Ask the students to explain what you just explained. And again, try to progress to their own words. So ask the students to describe what you just described. Ask the students to explain what you just explained, striving to get them to do it in their own words. What did we say teaching was? Confirming for joint possession. We want them to have the knowledge, have the skills, and we want them to make it their own. So then you can also ask students, why? Why is that structure important? Or why does that structure look like that? What are they going to use it for? Questions, 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 questions. Remember, the essence of science is inquiry, we're asking questions, and discovery, we're finding the answer. Inquiry and discovery, that's science. It's not dry lecture time. It's not supposed to be. Okay, they can read the book for that. So, do put the lesson in context. Don't just jump right in and here we are and it's unrelated to anything else. Do really teach. Do use the blackboard and any other visual aids you can. Do illustrate every point. Do repeat. Okay, and now don'ts. Some of this will overlap. Don't read your outline. Number one, presentation don'ts. Don't read your outline. You should never just get up there and dictate your outline. Your students aren't secretaries that are transcribing information, are they? They're supposed to be learning and understanding. So don't dictate your outline. You know what happens? The brains go off. You're teaching, you say Roman numeral number one, skeletal system. And then your students will not write again until you give them a clue word. Oh, capital letter A. That's my cue to write. No, you don't want them, they don't want to dictate your outline. That will happen. They'll completely shut their brain off and they'll become just like a secretary transcribing a letter. Okay? Your students are not secretaries transcribing information. They're supposed to be students learning. Okay? There should be much more to your lesson than just some outline. Okay? The outline is a means to an end. It's a way to organize. It's not what you're giving. Here is my outline. Okay? It's not inspired, is it? Okay? Do you understand what I'm saying? That's not, the outline is only a means to an end. It's a means of organization. It's not the actual information you're giving out. So, don't dictate your outline. The outline is only a means of organization. It's necessary, probably, for organization. It's not the basis of the presentation. Don't dictate your outline. It should not be the basis of your presentation. It should be only a means of organization. Okay, so your goal should not be to get through your outline. What should your goal be? Teaching a concept, confirming for joint possession, really teaching. Next, don't. Don't just give out information. I'm always kind of critical of history. I don't really like history, so I always slam history. But science class isn't history class where I'm giving out dates and names and places. History class really shouldn't be that either. You should be explaining events and how they fit together and so forth. But science seems to fall into this trap just as much as history can fall into the trap of just giving out information. Don't just give out information. First of all, describe structures. You need to explain their shape. What do they look like? How big are they? What is their color? How do they feel? Remember, we want to instill science skills, not just pass out information. You might as well just photocopy your outline and pass it out. Right? Okay. Describe structures. You're going to be detailing their shape, their size, their color, their texture. Have your students come up with their own descriptions. Give the students practice describing things. There's a lot more than science. There's a lot more than teaching, than just giving out information. So describe structures. Secondly, explain functions. How does this work? What's happening here? Lots of questions. We're answering questions. Remember, science is inquiry and discovery. So we're going to describe structures. How are they going to learn how to describe if they don't hear you describing? Right? Explain function. How does this work? Why does this do this? Show relationships. How do these organisms interact? How do these systems interact? Okay. How do the structures work together? Why is this designed this way? There's a lot of explaining and describing and things that you can do. You're not up there dictating an outline or just giving out names and places and information. So you want to describe structures. You want to explain function. You want to show relationship. And then you want to make application. You're not just giving out information. So don't dictate your outline. Don't just give out information. Don't do all the talking. Now in this format, I am doing all the talking, but not in your classroom. Don't do all the talking. A couple ideas here. Ask questions, constantly asking questions. Why do you think works this way? Why do we have two eyes? Because we look funny with one eye? No, there's a reason why we have two eyes. Okay, it's called bifocal vision. I can't think of anything off the top of my head right now, but why do birds have hollow bones? Why do birds not have teeth? Okay, all kinds of questions. It's don't do all the talking. So ask questions, and then number two, don't give all the answers. I'm not going to be doing all the talking. I'm asking questions, and I'm not giving all the answers. Get feedback from your students. They should be answering the questions. They should be supplying the descriptions. They should be asking the questions even. Don't do all the talking. Then, don't just lecture. Don't dictate your outline. Don't just give out information. Don't do all the talking. And don't just lecture. Science involves doing. So, science class, what we're saying here is don't just lecture. The first thing is that science class is not just lecture. Science class needs to involve doing science. The teacher does science and the students do science. So we have to do science. So my last don't is don't just lecture. Lecture is one component and one component only. Another point, as far as don't just lecture, your classroom has to revolve around inquiry and discovery. Towards the beginning of the lecture, we talked about what is science. Science is investigation. We inquire. That means we're going to ask a question. We're going to pose a problem. And then we're going to find the answer, discovery. So the classroom needs to revolve around inquiry and discovery. So the first thing that we're going to do that is we're going to practice science skills in class. All right, I talked about science skills, talked about observation, describing, and recording. So what can I do that? We can practice it right in class. Students don't know how to describe things. So what do? I bring in, let's say I'm teaching botany, one of the biological sciences, so I bring in a plant, and we practice describing the flower together. Okay? In the teaching science class, I do these things. And college students can't do it either. They don't have science skills. They were never taught them. They never practiced them. So we actually practice science skills as much as we can. This should be done weekly. Okay? So if I'm teaching botany, I practice. I use a flower to describe it, and I describe it with my class. I help them use descriptive adjectives. I tell them, okay, what do we need to do? We need to describe the size. So how can we describe the size? We can measure it, or we can compare it to a known object. I need to describe the color, and not just red. Work on descriptive adjectives. We go through it together. And then we do it on our own. We should be practicing science skills. Now, if your math class was taught to you just them showing you, the teacher showing them how to do a problem on the board, does that help you learn the math? No, hopefully you're at least practicing it for homework. But we want to teach this more like a math class. So we practice our science skills in class. The teacher can do it as a demonstration. We can do it together. And then we have to do it frequently. So practice the science skills in class, beginning with the teacher guiding it and progressing to doing it on their own. And do it frequently, as much as possible, at least a couple times a week. Practice your science skills. The other thing we can do is demonstrate demonstrate science concepts. We do some type of procedure in class, and we learn the concept that governs that procedure. This is especially true in the physical sciences, but even in the biological sciences. Okay? We can deal with, bring animals into the classroom. Fish are very handy. Okay, we can bring in fish, we can bring in, even have a mammal, or we can grow things in class, we can do actual demonstrations. Then the third thing that we can do is we can set up science experiments. So we can practice individual science skills. We can do science demonstrations that illustrate concepts. We can even, one thing that you could do in anatomy and physiology is you could illustrate how the diaphragm works and how the diaphragm actually draws air. You can use a balloon in a bottle. There's all kinds of things you can do to demonstrate. So there's like three levels of this. Practicing an individual science skill. I bring in my flower and we describe it. We work at it. Then I can do a demonstration that shows how a concept works. Then I could actually do a full-fledged science experiment where we have a question, we form a hypothesis, and then we experiment to test the validity of our hypothesis. That would be more like a lab where you would have to take several days to do it. But that is science class, not just me learning the 11 systems of the human body. Not me just learning the major organs in each system. Me memorizing the functions of each system. Do you see the difference? And a lot of this all stems back to your approach. How do you approach your science class? So, to sum that up, what are our do's? Do put the lesson in context. Do really teach. Do use the blackboard. Do illustrate as many points as possible. Do review ad nauseum. But don't dictate your outline. Don't just give out information. Don't do all the talking. And don't just lecture. Okay? We made it. And if you want to learn more, you can take Teaching Intermediate Science. It's ED 311. No, ED 316.